Hey everybody, Larry Lawton here. Do I have a great video for you today? I have John Brown, one of the leading trainers in boxing today and been for 50 years. We'll get into his story in a minute. Before I get started, check us out on Patreon, check us out on YouTube member program. First, let me introduce you to my friend. John Brown has a gym in Kansas City and we'll talk about it. He ended up training the heavyweight champ, Tommy Morrison, for years and through his fight with George Foreman or whoever he fought. We'll get into that a little bit. But more than that, he even helps young people every day to this day. It's his passion. That's what he does. John, welcome to the show.
Larry, nice to meet you. Nice to see you.
Yes.
I've been following your career. I want to tell you how proud we are. It shows you in America, somebody that puts their nose to the grindstone, wants to be successful, works their tail off, can be whatever they want to be. And you are the epitome of that, and I love you for it.
Thank you, John. I appreciate that. I know you really mean it. And I always say, no matter what mistakes we made beforehand, people can change. And they do. And we try to show that to young people on this channel that watch us to say, you know, hey, I'm a fuck up, I'm a screw up, I'm this. You're never far out of it. You know what I mean? No matter how bad you were, what you've done in life, you're never far out of it. I always say that. Let's get it to you, John. You got into boxing, and what always me, first of all, everybody, this is my trainer. If I fight Logan Paul, it's going to be, I don't know. This is the trainer I get. This is the man who trained world champions. But John, you got into boxing when you were young. You were 12 years old. Give us a little background of that.
Well, it's pretty simple. I was born, I give speeches from time to time to social groups, and they look at me and they go, oh yeah, you can tell he was a boxer. Well, my facial deformity is from a pretty common birth defect called a cleft palate and a cleft lip, and you're born with all this stuff as a part. Here, your nose is all over the place, you got a hole in the roof of your mouth, you got to sew all that fixed up. I've had about 7 operations just to look fairly normal and to sound fairly normal. But when I was 12, 13, 14 years old, I looked like somebody hit me in the face with a hatchet. I had a nasal, you know, I didn't speak real well. And everybody made fun of me.
You were bullied.
Bullied. And so whatever was inside of me just caused me to fight. Somebody made fun of me, they had a fight in my hand. I didn't win them all, but it worked out well because after when I was, I think, 13, I got in trouble with the juvenile court, got in trouble with the police for fighting, and one of the cops, a black man by the name of Bill Riley, he said, son, if you're going to fight so much, you should learn how to fight. So he took me to a gym in the worst part of Kansas City, in the worst part of St. Louis, I'm sorry.
Is this 12 years old?
Yeah, I was just 12. And as is, most of the boxing gyms are the blighted parts of the city. Not because that's where people like boxing, it's just because that's where the cheap buildings are. Because there's no money in amateur boxing. So that's why they're always in the worst neighborhood. So this police officer took me to a gym, and it was named Ringside. I was the only probably white person within 25 miles. And it was my home. They treated me like family. You know, I mean, in fact, in 1962, I was just started training there, and Charles Sonny Liston showed up, because my trainer there used to train Sonny when he was an amateur. And Sonny had just won the title from knocking out Floyd Patterson and showed up at the gym, and it was just, you know, spectacular for a young boxing fan like myself.
So you gravitated towards boxing. You had a pretty long amateur career.
Well, I didn't box a whole lot because of my birth defect. I had 4 or 5 operations. I was fragile. I was worried about getting, you know, having to have more surgery, getting whatever I had done, you know, rearranged. And so I did most of my boxing in the gym. And what attracted me to the sport was the fact that when I was growing up, I was kind of a punk. You know, I was a messed up kid. And once I got into boxing, I changed. I hardly got in any fights anymore. I didn't have to prove anything to anybody. Now, if somebody started giving me some shit, you know, I'm a counterpuncher, you know, to this day. You know, I don't ever start any fights, but if I see somebody bullying somebody, you know, I'm going to do something about it. Or if somebody gives me some shit, they're going to get some shit back. You know, that just was in us boxers, you know. And I teach my boxers that don't ever start a fight. But, you know, you defend yourself when you have to. And help other people if you have to. And if you get in trouble at school for that, I'll come and talk to the school principal and we'll work it out. You know how they are nowadays. I mean, if you even raise a fist at somebody, you're suspended for 5 days.
Yeah, they want you to go here or there. When I was younger, obviously, it was, you know, you take it out into the schoolyard and do what you got to do, you know. And nobody complained. Win, lose, or draw. You're right. I love, you know, a friend of mine told me a great story. He goes, told the guy, you know, have you ever been, you know, you ever lost a fight? And of course, I'll say, oh, always. And someone goes, yeah, anybody who says they never lost the fight just didn't fight the right guy. I mean, you know, because you're going to run into the guy that's going to, you know, obviously have more talent to you, whatever it is, get you quicker.
Well, not too long ago, I was on a radio talk show about bullying. And they had some psychiatrist on there and psychologist. They were all talking about how to handle bullies. And they were talking about how, you know, if you bully, tell your child just to walk, turn your back and walk away. And I'm on the phone screaming. I go, no, you don't. That's called pass the trash. Because the bully's just going to go bully somebody else. You know, teach your kid how some self-defense, whether it's wrestling, boxing, or martial arts, and, you know, somebody bullies you, boom, give me a little jab in the face, and get a little bloody nose, and he won't bully anybody anymore in most cases. And you've done the right thing. No, turn around, walk away. No, that's...
You know, it's funny, because in my own program, I talk about bullying, and I always say, let's get to the bully. Let's change the bully, because no bully just bullies one person. Helping the one kid who gets bullied is great. But let's help the bully who's, for whatever reason, he's lashing out. Most of them have some issues. Let's get to him, straighten him out, whether it's a 1-2, whatever it is, a wake-up call, however John does. A lot of, all of us have different ways, and obviously not one of us will ever abuse a kid, do anything wrong. Never. That's farthest thing from our minds. But we come from that old school that you know, some things need to be handled directly and not with a litany of paperwork and all the bullshit you want to put in it. But getting into John, what you're doing, you have a gym now in Kansas City, and you, what ages do you train from?
Well, because of my involvement in boxing, I developed this great passion for the sport. So I've been involved, let me ask you a question, second, I've been involved in the sport of boxing, every possible level known to man.
So the pro level, the middle level.
Everything.
Don't you do stuff with the Golden Gloves now?
Well, everything. You know, I started a boxing equipment company, and I named it after the gym I went to, which is called Ringside. So I started that in 1977. It grew to be one of the largest boxing equipment companies in the world. You know, a lot of people copying it. You know, the guys that started a company called Tiger, they all came from me, learned the business from me, took everything I had. But that's the way, you know, there's another company, the guy did the same thing that he started. But you know, and so I've just been involved, you know, I invented...
In boxing.
I just invented hundreds of products. I've always... You know, figure in the sport of boxing, because I've coached all the time. I've coached since I was 18 years old at college. And so I've been coaching for like 53, 54 years. And it's real simple for me. Boxing is not fun if it's not safe. You know, getting hurt and getting banged up doesn't make any, you know, kids are not going to be attracted to it. So when I started my equipment company, it was all about safety products, making products that were safe. You know, I was the first one to put Velcro straps on hand wraps. You know, I did that. Because in my gym, so many kids would come up there, because in the old days, you had strings, and I had the time, and I had 50 kids, I'm coaching by myself, you don't have time for that. So I just decided to, you know, do that, and
now it's the norm.
Yeah, and Velcro on gloves, I invented the super bag glove, which has probably been sold.
Let's get it to kids.
But,
obviously,
but the love you're and passion into... for all of that, through all of that, I was coaching kids, because I remember where I came from. I remember that sport probably kept me out of prison. I know that's a line you hear in movies and stuff, but it's true. And so I I'm not doing it. There's like 5,000 coaches in America coaching amateur boxing. No money involved. In fact, it's usually the opposite. You have to put money out of your pocket to keep the program going. And so so I've seen, not only with myself, but I've seen with hundreds of kids that I know and I get feedback from them about how we changed their life, how boxing helped their life, how boxing made them, you know, more self-disciplined, more self-control, and got their mind right, you know. And so...
Well, it's discipline. It's like anything else.
When you hear that, you know, it really motivates you, because as I tell people, you know, the best way to feel good about yourself is to help other people, especially young people.
Well, I'm big on this channel.
I'm telling Michelle, my partner, in life, that I'm at 74, amazingly so, because I thought maybe it might wane. I'm more enthusiastic about coaching than I've ever been, you know, because it's just fun.
And you see it. Obviously, you are on the pro level as well, and we're going to get to that well with some Tommy Morrison, some stories, or just of people that we know, we talk about, we have a lot of fun when we get together. I'm like you just said right there. You know, I tell young people every day on this channel, I says, do one thing good for somebody else. open a door, carry packages for an old lady. You'll feel better about yourself. You're helping somebody else. And I do that to this day, John. I actually sometimes take down my speed pass to go through tolls and put it down and down below and go through the toll booth itself and literally stop for 5-7 seconds and says, I hope you're having a good day. Thank you for doing what you do. We need people like you. You don't know if that guy had a bad day, he needed a thing, what he's thinking about in that booth all day, people just blowing by doing this. I make a point to do little things as much as I can.
A lot of people have tough jobs.
Yeah, and you know, people either don't recognize them, don't give a shit or shit on them. And I don't believe in that. I don't believe in a job. Any job is a shit job. I believe they're all needed in some way or other. What levels they are or not, it doesn't really matter to me. Because I know I want to see young people get 2 jobs or 3 or whatever it takes to figure out your life and get your life back on track. Whether it's, you know, because they were, oh, they think in the drug way is the easy way. The crime way like I did was the easy way. You know, I went through a lot of shit in my life to get to where I am. Obviously, people ask, well, you know, you're at one level, would you still do it? No. I would never lose my kids. My daughter was 15 months old, I got out, she's 13. My son is 6, I got out, and he's 18. I would never lose those years of my life for anything, because you could always make money, you could always do things if you're smart enough. Let's get back into the boxing, because, you know, you got to get me ready for Logan Paul. He's 24. I'm a little old. I still got moves, still got a little power. And, you know, you got to train. I know you got to get me in shape. That's the big part.
Boxing, 90% is conditioning. You know, you got to take care of that. I'll take care of the 10% of teaching you how to do it right.
Do it right. Make right. Sure I win. You know, John and I were talking earlier, and we really come up with this thing. People, because actually we just put it up, and a lot of people say, yeah, no, yeah. Who knows? You know, we're just having fun, because I'm going to start getting back in shape. It's one of my goals of this year by the end of for my birthday year. So, but John, you started boxing and you started getting bigger and bigger. And how did you get to, first of all, anybody out there doesn't know who Tommy Morrison, you gotta go on YouTube, watch a video of Tommy Morrison you told me about. And
the legendary power of Tommy Morrison.
The legendary power of Tommy Morrison. And obviously that was John's guy. How did you meet him and how did it start?
There was a kid that showed up from Arkansas fighting in gold gloves. He's a 190-pound fat white kid, but I noticed he had some hand speed, and he was a heavyweight. He only weighed, well, like I say, 190, so he was a light, not a really heavy heavyweight, but, and he was beating people in Kansas City, which wasn't usually that tough. So I got attracted to it. I thought maybe I saw something there. I saw something that could be developed. I saw a lot of work, and I found out he had never had any formal training. So I talked to him and his father. I said, you guys want to, you know, you want to join? Come. They lived in Jay, Oklahoma. I said, you want to come to Kansas City? You can work for my company. I had my company ringside at that time was blossoming. And I said, you work for the company, I'll train you, you know, because I've got a gym with a lot of other people. So they did, and we did. And so.
Did you know right off the bat that he had something special to go to become the world champ of boxing? I mean, that's a big deal, no matter how you cut the dice.
Not really, because, you know, that there are things that you look for that I can't teach. I can't teach work ethic. I can't teach self-discipline. I can't teach the ability to absorb coaching.
Heart.
You know, and well, the heart, and I can't teach mental toughness, which is kind of heart. And so, you know, you got to have that. And the ones that have that are the ones that end up being great fighters. Marvin Hagler, of course, had that kind of stuff. You know, he was a blue-collar guy. So we were around the country to amateur boxing tournaments. He fought in the Olympic trials in 1990, and he ended up fighting Ray Mercer in the finals, and he lost to Ray Mercer. And
then who became the world champ himself?
Well, Ray Mercer became the gold medalist in the
and I think a world champ as well, right?
Game. Yeah, I think he may have been one of those titles. But, and we ended up meeting him in the pros, and that didn't turn out so well. But and then we turned pro, and of course there was a big market for a white heavyweight. That could, you know, that if we dubbed it, that could KMFO, knock motherfuckers out, because that's what people want to see. And I taught Tommy, you know, I'm left-handed, and I boxed left-handed as a child, but I switched about being right-handed, so I have a very good right hand, a very good jab, a very good left hook. I taught Tommy Morris how to throw a left hook. And because he had hand speed, natural athleticism, and at that time, in the early days, a good work ethic, you know, he developed a hell of a left hook. And so, as the fights grew on, we had about 7 or 8 fights. I got fights for him locally. My company was growing at 30% a year. I couldn't handle all this stuff. So I did a little kind of a slick thing. There was a guy named Bill Caton in New York. Bill Caton was one of the managers, the original managers of Mike Tyson. And Bill Caton also had the largest fight film collection in the world. I wrote Bill a letter. I said, Bill, I've got a heavyweight. Someday we're going to fight Mike Tyson. Would you mind renting me some Mike Tyson video? Because we're going to start studying his style now in preparation for their fight. And I was really trying to get Bill interested in Tommy, and I did. Bill flew to Kansas City. We worked a deal. He became a co-manager with me. He was in for 10%. And from there, because Bill had such great connection with ABC and all the network, I mean, a couple of months later, Tommy fight on ABC Wild World of Sports, 6-round fight. And so it moved quickly.
Yeah, and then he ended up winning the title against George Foreman, wasn't it?
That was on June 7th of 1993.
He beats George Foreman, like one of your all-time great Hall of Fame boxer for sure, one of the best knockout artists in the game. And he actually beats him because you trained him different, didn't you?
Yeah, actually it was because I was so involved with my company, I had to have help training Tommy. I brought a good friend of mine, Dr. Tom Vergette, in. And Tom became the lead trainer for the last couple of years. And it was Tom's idea to train Tommy to be more of a boxer than a puncher. And I was always there, Tom and I always worked together on strategy and how to get Tom. Because as time went by, we found out that Tommy didn't have a great work ethic. He didn't have hardly any self-discipline. He didn't have the mental toughness it takes to do what coal miners do, what people do in factories. They never get up every day, do what you got to do, come home, and the next day you do it again. Tommy wasn't good at that. Tommy was more interested in being a playboy and being a rebel rouser and, getting in trouble.
And a side note, we'll get in. Tommy ended up dying, passing, sadly, of HIV, AIDS. He ended up dying of that back then, and that we'll get in a little bit later. So you get this kid, you feel he's got the talent, but he doesn't have certain, but he still gets to the level where he's got to fight George Foreman. Did you think he was going to win that fight? I mean, being honest.
Not really.
Right?
But he did train harder for that fight than any other fight. We never knew he was going to win. We picked his opponent very carefully, and we never knew because he didn't have the stamina. That just wasn't his forte because he wouldn't train hard enough for that. Tommy was a killer for 5 rounds. After that, he'd be in trouble. But he had some great fights. He had a fight on ABC Wild World of Sports with Joe Hip, in which Tommy ended up breaking both his hands, and he got his jaw broke, and he ended up knocking Joe Hip out in the 9th round. What a spectacular fight.
Wow. With two broken hands and a broken hip.
A broken jaw. Yeah. So, I mean, as I try to tell people, Tommy was very tough. But the difference between being tough and having mental toughness. Tough is the guy, you and I get in a fight and I beat the hell out of you, and you keep coming, you're tough, okay? But to get a boxer or any human being to do something monotonous and something that's tough, day after day after day after day, probably like your father did, like my father did, even a plumber, getting up every day and dealing with shit every day. Those guys, that's mental
toughness. Mental toughness.
And there's a big difference, And Tommy didn't have that mental toughness.
So in the boxing world,
Tommy could have had the hand speed, and the power to be one of the greatest fighters ever. He had that ability, but he didn't have the other component. He didn't have that
work ethic.
That Marvin Hagler, Evander Holyfield work ethic.
Yeah, and Mayweather and the people like that who actually must train so much that it becomes an obsession, obviously.
And they make themselves great.
Yeah. Well, there's that fine line they always say between good and great. It's that little extra, day in the gym or extra miles on the road or whatever.
I just wrote a manual about that. What's the difference between good and great? And it's talked about all that self-discipline, all that work ethic, all that stuff you got to do for my amateur boxers, because I've got about 100 of those.
So you got 100 boxers right now in Kansas City from 12 to, from 5 to 12, I think you told me.
Well, we never turn anybody away.
Right.
If you want to learn how to box, I don't care if you want to compete.
So you're inviting me into the gym to get going again and ready to go?
I want people to, if they come for a week or they come for a month, they come for 10 years, I want them to leave the sport having a good experience. So they think
positive. So your best attribute, would you say, is teaching a person how not to get hit?
Well, in our gym, we do two things. We don't have any speed bags. We don't jump rope. Now, those are good things. They're not bad. They're not bad conditioners, all that. But the two things we do in our gym, we teach people how to hit and how to not get hit. And hitting a speed bag and jumping rope got nothing to do with hitting and not being hit. So, and I only have these kids for a certain amount of time. I don't want them there for 3 hours a day. I want, boxing is a hobby. Come in for an hour and a half, boom, go home and help your mother clean up the house, do some homework, whatever you got to do. So the only thing we teach is how to hit, how not to be hit. And we spend as much time on how not to be hit as hitting, which probably makes us I would probably guess maybe the only gym in America that does that. Because I'm always appalled when I go to another gym and I see all they're talking about is offense, offense, offense. You know, all they teach, that's all they do. And boxing basically is all offense. You hit, you're shadow boxing, you shadow box against an imaginary opponent, you're hitting him. You hit heavy bang doesn't hit back, you got a double end bang, rubber cable, it doesn't hit back, it kind of comes at you, move a little bit. But all those things have to do with offense. But you got to teach defense because, as I teach the kids and I tell the kids from the day they walk in the gym, I'm here to protect what's inside here, which is, they all know, their brain. I have a nonverbal contract with their parents to protect them. This is a contact sport. The object of the sport is to hit each other in the head with blunt trauma force, as hard as you can. And so, and that sounds kind of violent for most people. I've got kids that have boxed with me for 6, 7, 8, 10 years and had 50, 60 fights, have sparred hundreds, if not thousands of rounds, and been hit hard maybe 5 times, literally. Because they know how to not get hit. I mean, like any other activity, the more you practice it, the better you get. So we have lots of partner drills that teach people how not to get hit.
Right, obviously in the amateur level.
Give me to interrupt you, but I think we have a mutual friend named Dr. Frank Filiberto. He told me once, he's a famous doctor. He told me that giving hit in the head was not a healthy thing.
Yeah, I'll bet he did.
And I took that to heart.
I know Doc Filiberto, who he's talking about, is one of our good friends and a ringside doctor, boxing, and ENT surgeon, plastic surgeon. The guy's done it all. He's a good friend of ours. I'm going to have him on one day because he's got some crazy stories. But, getting back to the aspect of what you do at your gym and how you help people and how the discipline comes, what I always knew about you from the day I met you, it was always about trying to help somebody. Again, you're not finding the next, I don't think, and you hopefully, but finding some great heavyweight champ out there that's just going to come. Might happen. I hope it happens. We need it. We need the sport to get back into it. But you're teaching people how to get the discipline, defenses. Obviously, it doesn't hurt to know how to hit, turn your shoulders and hit somebody.
Well, we give kids self-confidence. We teach them work ethic. We teach them the fact that there's a connection between working and success. Because the kids that work the hardest have the most success. I go to several local high schools, because this sport seems to attract kids that have problems. And it attracts kids that have that don't want to play on team sports. They want to play. They want to be involved in singular kind of sports, which boxing is, wrestling, whatever. But I go talk to the vice principal because they're the ones handling all the bad kids. I always tell them, I say, listen, I got the boxing program, I got literature, blah, blah, blah. Send me all your knuckleheads. That's what we like. I like knuckleheads. I've had two of them look at me and go, you want me to send the whole school there? No, I can't handle the whole school. But send me your troublemakers and we'll fix them. And most of the time we can, because there's an equalization that happens in the gym. First of all, the guys that think they're tough, they come to the gym and they'll see a kid half their age, half their size, and that could probably beat the hell out of them.
Right.
Because they learn this, the skills in boxing are amazing. How I even take it for granted until I have one of my really good boxers spar with a new guy to help him out, just to let him get used to the ring. And I'm just amazed how skillful these guys are. I kind of lose track of it sometimes. So to be a successful boxer, it just takes so much work and talent and skill to do that. And so you get these tough guys, these bullies or whatever come in, they see that, they'll go, I know they're going, holy Christ, there's 25 guys in this gym that could beat the shit out of me, And it changes attitudes,
What can young people do today to get in, whether it's my audience want to just try a boxing program, something for discipline, is there something to look for in a gym? Obviously not everybody can't come to Kansas City to your gym, but if they're in the area, obviously we're going to put a link right here below of his gym and his information and stuff like that if you want, right below this video. So, but as far as John, what would you recommend to kids all around the world?
Well, first of all, hopefully the young person going in the gym with a parental figure, somebody who's responsible for him. And that person should be talking to the coach and tell me how you teach this sport. Are you going to protect my young man? Are you going to protect, his fragile little organ called the brain? Because that's otherwise I don't want to be here. And there is, believe it or not, there's a way, and I've make videos. I'm getting ready to make a bunch of more videos. Now, I'm not going to compete with you. But
no, but we're going to have, I love them.
They're going to be shorter videos, because most of my videos were like an hour and a half long, and I don't know if I have the attention span anymore. But, you know, this sport can be very safe. I've never had a kid in 16,000 kids plus in whatever, 54, I've never had a kid get a concussion. You know, because you can do it right. But I've been to other gyms.
And you train world champs, so it's not like you're training lesser people.
I've been to other gyms. I go to different cities. I like to do a gym tour just to see what everybody's doing, because that's how you learn. You got to learn all the time. I learn stuff all the time. You know, come up with new training techniques, new things that the teacher guys. But I've been in gyms and I've gone outside and cried at what I see.
You know, yeah, it hurts you because you
see people in the sparring trying to kill one another. The coach is egging them on. You know, knock him out, kill him. You know, I mean, just crazy stuff. You know, 12-year-old kid sparring. And you want to, you know, ring him by the neck, the coaches and stuff. So parents have to, and hopefully they do that with other sports, just find out who's teaching. I think every young person in America should be involved in some combat sport, whether it be wrestling, I love wrestling, or boxing, or martial arts, or anything. You know, because it gives them that confidence they need. And plus, it's good physical activity. You know, in a physical activity, especially for a confused teenager, it's better for their head, or as much as good for their head as it is their body. You know, these kids nowadays got all kinds of stuff going on, just like you and I did, you know. And there's nothing healthier, and I advise adults too. You know, the great part about boxing, you come in, you hit heavy bags, and you hit other kind of bags, and they don't hit back, they don't call the police, they don't call the child abuse or the wife abuse. Or
get some energy out.
And you just feel, after, you know.
Yeah.
And now, the same thing, it's not just on sport. You know, my significant other is a marathoner, and she gets it by running. She gets that high, that feeling.
That endorphin high, we call it.
And I keep trying to tell her to run a little bit less, and she's like, if I do, I'll probably end up choking you, you know, because of all my stress and anxiety in life, so I just keep running, you know. So, I mean, And for the people that just have maybe a little more aggressiveness in them, you know, that's the people that seem to gravitate to our sport, you know. And I'm just the luckiest guy in the world to spend my whole life in the sport.
Thanks, guys. Make sure you check it out. Put this on your playlist. Pass it around. You know, any boxers, any kids, there is ways to get help. There's ways to even get funded. The donations, I have it. A lot of different people have it. And remember, make one good choice a day and keep doing that. Don't end up where I am. Have a great day.
I'd like to bring up one more point, though.
Go ahead.
You, the other day, you addressed me, and you called me old man.
You know why? Do you have a problem with that?
I got a little problem with that, because I am an old man, but I can still fight.
What are you going to do? What are you going to do?